Oh, you have a computer here. Is this on the internet?
It's all right. Don't worry. I'll
That's some data functions, I guess.
Mm-hmm. All right, we're ready to start. Gnome LPs will start with the first lecture. Lattices and modular form.
Right. Specifically data functions. Well, thank you. Thanks to the organizers for the invitation. Thanks also to Abhinav, who has been and I am sure will continue to be quite useful with the project. Following John Conway on any topic is daunting, especially on this one, for which his magnum opus with Sloan, Free Packing, Lattices and Groups, was my first major introduction to this topic, alongside with Sarah's course in arithmetic. Thankfully, some of the concepts were introduced by previous speakers. I still have this problem that I'm speaking to at least two audiences, namely the students who are doing specific projects with me, and everybody else who is a participant in the winter school, and they have somewhat conflicting demands. I do have most of my notes online. It's over 50 pages by now. They're not quite complete yet. So my plan is to give something of an overview of, let's say, highlights of the techniques and what they can accomplish today, and then over the next three lectures, fill in some details, give some more examples of where these ideas and techniques can lead, etc. So as we already learned, quadratic forms come in many flavors. I'm going to be concerned with a very specific case where we are looking at quadratic forms, positive definite quadratic forms over V, which is to say, equivalently, some lattice, I guess I have to write bigger here, some lattice, I'd better not allow to actually equal Rn unless n is zero, but it's some positive definite lattice, and with the further requirement that this lattice have inner products which take rational values. And most of what I'll say with, some of what I'll say will hold in this greater generality. Can everybody see what I'm writing there, by the way? Okay, if you can't, please give me a hint. And often I'll specialize even more narrowly to situations, notably where, let's say, L might be self-dual. That's a huge specialization. To remind you, the dual lattice is defined to be the set of all vectors in the ambient real space, let's call them dual vectors, such that the inner product with any lattice vector is an integer. And it is always a lattice in its own right, but very rarely is it the same as the original lattice. A famous equivalent condition is that the inner product take integral values and the discriminant should be, well, usually plus or minus one, but I'm in a positive definite situation here, so discriminant is better equal plus one. Why do I restrict my domain of attention so narrowly? Well, for one thing, it makes it easier to get to some of the remarkable results without developing as much machinery as I may or will have to do in the next few days. Also, it, for such a special case, it is remarkably ubiquitous. And as often happens in mathematics, by concentrating our attention more narrowly, we can see further and in more detail. So to give an example of the kind of details that we can obtain, let us look at the even more special case where, well, let's say n equals 48. And suppose the lattice has a property that if you look at any vector in the lattice, the vector norm, and by the way, I'm always going to use the norm for the inner product of unit itself and not the square root of that, which would be the length. Okay, so I'm going to require that this, which a priori is a non-negative integer, I'm requiring it to be an even integer. so no ones, threes, or fives, etc. That is actually a natural condition, as we'll see if you haven't seen this already, basically because the map from a vector to its normal 2 is a homomorphism, given that the lattice is integral. So I'm basically asking that this homomorphism be the zero homomorphism. And then I'm going to impose two further conditions, which are natural from the point of view of sphere packing, that is to say, using the lattice centers as the centers of equal Euclidean spheres, which I'm going to try to pack as densely as possible. And given that the discriminant is 1, the bigger the minimal radius or the minimal norm, what happened there? Ah, thank you. I guess that's a hint. the bigger the minimal radius or minimal norm, the bigger the spheres you'll be able to pack with the same density. Oh yeah, that looks much better. Okay, so n is 48. V, for all lattice vectors, I want the inner product to be 0, and then I want allow 2 and 4 to force the inner products to be at least 6, the norms to be at least 6, the inner products can be any integers, and that's all that I require. And it turns out that once you know that, and by the way, there are several lattices like that known. There isn't a complete classification, but there are several such known, at least 3 of last count, maybe there's a 4th one since then. And remarkably, once you know this much, you know a whole bunch of other things about the lattice. For instance, evidently 0 occurs with multiplicity only 1. 6 is going to occur always with the same multiplicity, which might not be as obvious. 52,416,000, exactly. And 8 will occur with some other fourth multiplicity, 10, etc. I'm not going to give you the whole list here. I prepared a list of some numbers. So I guess you can see here, that's the number of vectors of norm 8, 39 billion and change. And these numbers are constant for spheres of this kind, for lattices of this kind. And you can say something more, namely, you can say that if you look at the spheres in any one of these shells, let's say the 52 million plus spheres of the minimal norm of 6, minimal non-zero norm of 6, they are very evenly distributed in, well, various senses, some of which we'll discover later, but I'll describe one of them. So suppose I look at any one of these 39 billion plus vectors and ask, given that vector, what are the inner products of these minimal vectors with that vector? Well, by just some standard Cauchy-Schwarz, it's not just Cauchy-Schwarz, you find that if you look at V0, V, remember VV is 8, excuse me, VV is 6, and I fix some vector V0 of norm 8, then what can the inner products of V0 with V be? Well, they have to be either 0 plus or minus 1 plus or minus 2, 3, or 4, and no more. Cauchy-Schwarz would allow them to be as large as 6, but if there were 6, let's say, the difference between the two vectors would have inner product 2 in itself. Likewise, if there was a 5, the inner product of the norm of V plus or minus V naught would be 4. That's not allowed, so it has to take on one of these values. And my claim is that the multiplicities are always the same for any such lattice and any one of those vectors. And, well, here they are. Of course, the multiplicities of plus 1 and minus 1 are the same, because if I have inner product 1 here, I have inner product minus 1 for negative the vector, which has the same norm. But it's not so obvious that the multiplicities are actually these numbers here. In particular, they're exactly 2256 having the maximal possible inner product. So the first project that I hope some of my students will undertake is to obtain some further combinatorial information along these lines for any one of these lattices and analogous questions about lattices of the same kind in other dimensions. So where does such detailed information come from? And another remarkable thing about this kind of mathematics is that even though it seems like basically an enumerative question in number theory, the techniques actually involve a good helping of real and complex analysis. Specifically, they involve, the main other topic of my title besides lattices, which is Taylor functions. I'll try to be very careful to distinguish this capital Greek Taylor from the lowercase one, which is basically the same thing but with a change of variables. And with apologies to John Conway, I'll put in the customary 1/2 factor here in the exponent, and I'll define that to be the sum over all lattice vectors of q to the power half the norm of v, or equivalently, it's going to be the sum over all k bigger than zero, for which the number of lattice vectors is of norm k is non-zero, q to the power k over 2, and since I'm summing over non-zero numbers, that's 1 plus that. And what is that? Well, for one thing, it's, you know, I can think about it either formally as a generating function or as an actual function of a variable q, in which case it makes sense, let us say it converges absolutely, for at least non-negative q less than 1. You can't expect to extend it past 1. You might wonder what happens there is a complex when q is allowed to be a complex variable, and we'll come back to that later. But what it is, it's a generating function for these numbers n sub k of l. And it has some nice generating functionological properties. Most nicely, perhaps, is that if you take the direct sum of two lattices, then, just as was true for some of the other invariants we heard about earlier, the Taylor functions multiply. So, for instance, if you are trying to count representations of numbers as sums of four squares, you are basically asking for the Taylor function of the lattice V4, V4 after all being the lattice for which the normal vector is the sum of the squares of its four coordinates, and that is equal to the Taylor function of V to the power 4. And the Taylor function of V is just some very familiar power series, 1 plus q to 1/2 times 2 plus q to 4/2 plus q to 9/2, etc., all that raised to the power, well, in our case, 4. So, with the customary, we have to remember that negative 3 also has a square of 9. At any rate, and so, if we have some insight about these generating functions, then we can get at things like which numbers are presented as sums of 4 squares, and in how many ways. And likewise, sums of 2 squares, values of other quadratic forms, and so forth. Now, this generating function has a remarkable property, which is that it satisfies this functional equation, which is on my third page. Oh, here it is. Here we go. So remember, theta L of Q, sum over lattice vectors of Q to the half, the norm, and remarkably enough, the Taylor function of, well, here's another way of thinking about it, besides a generating function. This is a sum over a lattice of some function, some nice, rapidly decaying function, and we can apply Poisson summation to that. So, to remind you in general, Poisson summation in this context says that the sum over lattice vectors of essentially any function for which you can hope to make sense of this is equal to some factor which is the discriminant to the minus a half, or if you prefer, 1 over the covolume, times a similar sum running over the dual lattice of the Fourier transform evaluated at V star, where the Fourier transform is being normalized so that Well, I'm using this normalization. It's the integral of e to 2 pi I times the inner product times f of x relative to the standard measure on Rn. So one way you can think about it is that this sum is a Riemann function for the integral of f over the whole plane, over the whole space, excuse me. If you just look at the v star equals zero term, that's the integral it's trying to approximate, and with the discriminant L2 minus a half, because that has to do with how dense the lattice is, and all the other terms for v star not equal to zero are correction terms. So that's Poisson summation, say, beautiful result of probably somewhere around 19th century mathematics, at least in this n-dimensional version of it, and in particular, if we apply it to this function here, okay, you can actually sort of see that. Well, this function, if you think about a function of all of Rn, is basically a Gaussian. It's exponential of minus the norm times some constant, and it's a standard fact that will emerge as soon as I find the correct page of my notes, that the Fourier transform of such a function is again of the same kind up to scaling. So if f of x is, and here the nice way to normalize it is say e to the power minus pi times some constant times the norm, then the Fourier transform is again the same thing, except you change pi t to pi t inverse, and you multiply by this factor, which is t to the minus n over 2. And you do the usual sanity check that if you apply this twice, well, the Fourier transform of an even function is the same function, so I'd better come back where I started, and indeed the two powers of t cancel each other out. It's t to the minus n over 2 times 1 over t to the n over 2, so I do come back where I started. And so that means the value of theta function of L at q, if q is equal to e to the minus 2 pi t, the way I'm organizing it, is going to equal the value of the Fourier transform at e to the minus, excuse me, the value of the theta function for the dual lattice, that's what shows up here, evaluated at some complementary choice of q. So here is the equation, the theta series evaluated at e to the power, okay, how did I normalize this here? 2 pi t, if you evaluate it for the dual lattice, equals, again, the same factor, that's the discriminant of L to the plus a half, the discriminant of the dual lattice to the power minus a half, times t to the minus n over 2, times e to the power, excuse me, here it is, times the theta function for L, evaluate e to the power minus 2 pi over t. Again, this makes sense because the dual of the dual lattice is the lattice I start out with. Now, already for n equals 1, that's a very non-trivial identity. As an example of how non-trivial it is, you can use it already for n equals 1 to get the nicer of Riemann's proofs of the functional equation for the zeta function. And there is a generalization of this zeta function identity, which I recite in the lecture notes, which applies to the zeta function of any lattice. I remind you that zeta of s equals the sum over integers of n to the minus s. You can think about as a sum over non-zero n of n squared to the minus s over 2, maybe divided by 2. And the point is that this n squared is a value taken by quadratic form at all non-zero points in a single variable. Well, you can form the analog of this, ignoring this fudge factor of a half that will appear on either side of the function equation. You can take the analogous thing for any quadratic form and you'll get a zeta function of the quadratic form, which satisfies the functional equation, which you can prove in the same way, starting from this more general identity. I should have perhaps mentioned at the beginning, there are two kinds of theta functions in literature. There's this one, and there are these Jacobi theta functions, and they are related to each other in some sense, like if I let L be a one-dimensional lattice, and I twiddled my theta function a bit, I recovered Jacobi theta functions, but mostly I'm not going to be talking about Jacobi theta functions. This will be the only kind of thetas, this and its generalizations, be the only kind of thetas that I work with. Okay, so that satisfies, so this is a basic functional equation for theta functions, and it looks even nicer in this case where I let L equal L star to save the lattice self-dual. So what happens in that case? First of all, a self-dual lattice is unimodular, it has determinant 1. So this term cancels out, this term just becomes 1, L is the same as L star, and so I just get a functional equation relating this theta function to itself. Again, with the obligatory t to the power minus n over 2 factor. Now, I have this, but what's more, remember, if L is L star, then all the lattice norms are integers, because any vector dot itself is a vector inner product with a dual vector, so it has to be an integer. That means all of these exponents of Q that occur, these are all half integral. So even though the theta function might not make sense as a function of Q, it makes sense as a function of Q squared. And an even better way of saying that is to introduce, to make the change of variables where I take Q equals e to the 2 pi I t, tau, Q equals e to the 2 pi I tau, which might be e to the power 2 pi t, right? So here I was basically using e to the minus 2 pi t and saying that if I think about this as being a function of a complex variable t, then its invariant under t goes to t plus 2i, because that way I go twice around the origin and I come back to the same. But it's nicer if I make it, if I put the factor of I there, that means that my transformation is not translation by 2i, but translation by 2, and that will make sense if t is in the upper half plane, often denoted by script h, because it's also something usually called the hyperbolic plane, although that's going to lead to some notational conflicts in this particular context where hyperbolic plane has another meaning. So let me just call that the upper half plane. Fortunately, h also stands for half plane. So, at any rate, what we find then is that we satisfy the following equation. Let's use lowercase theta. Theta sub L of tau is big theta of e to the power 2 pi I tau. And once I do that, my functional equation reads as follows. Theta sub L of minus 1 over tau equals, how's it going to work then? Let me make sure that I have the same conventions here as there. Yeah, it's equal to tau over I to the power n over 2 times theta L of tau, where by this I mean I'm in the upper half plane, so tau over I is some number which is in the right half plane, take its principal square root, that's in the right quarter plane, and take the n over second, and take the nth power of that. So that's what this gadget here means. And also, theta L of tau equals theta L of tau plus 2. That's because all of the exponents that will appear here, right? So This is because theta L of tau is just the sum, well, let's say 1 plus the sum of n sub k over 2, excuse me, n sub k e to the power pi k I tau, and this is just ranging over integers. Now, having done that, you can iterate this identity over, you know, you can go from tau to tau plus 2, and then you can take that and take minus 1 over that, and maybe you can subtract 6, which is invariant under, take minus 1 over that, and so forth. So you get a whole bunch of identities, and these identities are all of the following form. Now, we have to know how fractional linear transformations are acting, and there is this remarkable fact that fractional linear transformations, tau goes to A tau plus B over C tau plus D, compose just like 2x2 matrices A, B, C, D, except that you can't tell whether A, B, C, D, you can't distinguish a matrix from its negative. The reason for that, ultimately, is that these, besides being fractional linear transformations, what they really are is projective linear transformations. They're this matrix acting on, I mean, if you think of tau as being a coordinate on the projective line, this is acting on basically the column vector tau 1, taking it to A tau plus B, C tau plus D, so it's acting on the projective coordinate in exactly the same way. That explains why these transformations are consistent. And our basic generators here are minus 1 over tau, so that's this matrix. That's yet another reason why it was nice to put in this factor of I. You might have thought that it made matters worse by forcing you to use this negative sign here, which arose as, you know, I squared, but actually that's nicer because this matrix has determinant 1 instead of minus 1. And the other matrix is translation by 2, and I'm going to call that T squared because eventually I'll be interested in translation by 1 as well. So, anytime that you have a, you know, some gamma, which is A, B, C, D, in the span of S and T squared, then I have an identity of this kind, and that identity is of the following form. It says that theta L, of A tau plus B over C tau plus D equals, well, I know what I want to say, I just want to make sure I have, I'd better say it correctly, equals C tau plus D to the n over 2, I believe is what I want, yeah, because this is what happens here, times some fudge factor depending only on CD, which is an eighth root of unity, like here it was an eighth root of unity because I raised I to some half integral power, times theta L of T. I'm not going to say much more about this multiplier system of epsilon CDs to the n, beyond observing that even the fact that it's internally consistent, that is to say that it has a definition that behaves correctly under composition of these fractional transformations, that's a non-trivial fact that is ultimately tantamount to quadratic reciprocity. So whether you're doing invariance of quadratic forms or you're doing complex analysis of theta functions, quadratic reciprocity is sort of a basic ingredient of the mathematical world that you're inhabiting. So this is going to be the case for all gamma in this group. And what is that group? Well, it's generated by integer matrices determinant 1, so it had better have determinant 1. And the full group of matrices of determinant 1 is called, well, I'm just going to call it gamma. Remember, I can't tell gamma a matrix, capital gamma. Remember, I can't tell a matrix from its negative, so it's not SL2Z, but PSL2Z. That's SL2Z divided by its identity matrix. And I'm going to call the subgroup that these generate gamma plus. What's gamma plus? Well, a necessary condition is that if you reduce a matrix mod 2, and that makes sense because changing a matrix by minus 1 doesn't change reduction by 2. If you reduce a matrix mod 2, well, this one goes to the identity. This one is, well, it started as an involution. It remains an involution. And so that tells you that gamma plus contains at most those matrices in SL2Z such that gamma mod 2 is either the identity or this involution. And it turns out that that necessary condition is also sufficient. So it's this particular index tree subgroup of gamma. In particular, it's a kind of subgroup that's called a congruence subgroup. That is to say, the subgroup cut out by some congruence conditions on the entries of the matrix. So the usual terminology for the statement that theta L is a holomorphic function in the upper half plane that transforms in this fashion and that satisfies some growth conditions that are basically a consequence of that, basically saying as you let tau go out to I infinity, e to the power pi kit goes to zero, and so it approaches one, particularly it remains bounded, and similarly as it approaches points on the rational points, the real axis, it doesn't quite stay bounded, but it doesn't grow faster in polynomial. That is expressed by saying that that the theta function of a lattice is a modular form of weight n over 2 for gamma plus, and to be precise, these multipliers epsilon cd to the n. So, okay, what does that tell us? Well, quite a bit, because it turns out that there aren't that many modular forms of weight n over 2 for this group. In fact, they all modular forms for any congruent subgroup of any weight form a fine-dimensional vector space, and this particular vector space is known explicitly. It's a fine-dimensional vector space, and in fact, its dimension is equal to 1 plus the greatest integer in n over 8. Not only that, I can tell you exactly a basis for that form. I could tell you a basis for that form, but I suspect I don't have quite enough time to do it. What time? How much time do I have?
About
20 minutes. Okay, I will refer you to the lecture notes then for an explicit description of this vector space. I will mention that this already has some, you know, applications to the classification of quadratic forms. So, for instance, supposing I knew that n is less than 8, that means that this vector space is one-dimensional, and I know one more thing about the theta function, namely, I know that its value at q equals 0 is 1. So that cuts it down from a one-dimensional space to a point in the one-dimensional space. And basically what it says is there's only one possible theta function for an L function of for a self-dual lattice of rank n if n is less than 8. Using this wonderful combination of complex analysis and arithmetic, and that theta function, well, we already know a lattice of that dimension, namely Zn. So the theta function of my new lattice has to be the same as the theta function of Zn, which is to say the number of ways it represents any integer is the same as the number of ways that Zn represents it. That by itself might not necessarily mean the lattices are equivalent. There are famous examples, which we'll see later this week, of pairs of lattices which have the same theta function, which are not equivalent. But if one of the lattices is Zn, the other one has to be also, basically because it has n pairs of vectors of norm 1. And those form an orthogonal frame, basically by Cauchy-Schwarz and the requirement that the lattice be self-dual. Once you have an orthogonal frame, you have a copy of Zn in your lattice. And once you have a copy of Zn, And instead of dual lattice, it has to be Vn, because if it's any bigger, well, there are various ways of seeing it. For any bigger, the discriminant would be less than one, or you know, the fact that the inner product with any vector in orthogonal frame is an integer makes you an integer vector. One way or another, this gives an easy proof of this classification. And if you go to the exercises in the lecture notes, you'll see that with just a bit more, you can actually go up the classification of self-dual lattices quite a bit just using the description of this vector space. In fact, by the time you get to the end of chapter 3 or 4 of the notes, you will be able to classify all lattices that are self-dual up to rank 15. By the way, in each dimension, there's a finite number of them, but the numbers eventually grow rapidly. So for instance, they have been classified up to dimension 26 or so, and 32, let's say, is probably hopeless because the numbers are literally in the millions. So getting up to 15 is already, in some sense, getting most of the way towards what we have any hope of making a complete list of. Okay, so now, better yet, so far I've been doing just self-dual lattices. I'm going to impose an additional condition that the lattice be even. That is to say, remember, it's that condition that for all lattice vectors, the inner product is not only an integer, but twice an integer. If I do that, that means that, remember, each one of the terms here, q to the power a half v comma v times, just half v comma v, each one of these terms is q to an integer power, and so if q is e to 2 pi I tau, then its invariant under tau goes not just to tau plus 2, but to tau plus 1. And so that means that my theta function transforms under the modular group under gamma for all gamma in the modular group. With the same rule, and you might wonder what happened to those pesky epsilons to the power n. And what happened to them is the following. Not only is this group generated by S and T, but we have generators and relations for it. It's generated by S and T subject only to the conditions that S squared is the identity and ST cubed is the identity. Now, if you apply this to gamma equals ST cubed, apply this to gamma of ST and iterate 3 times, you find theta L of T equals some factor times theta L of tau. All of the factors of C tau plus D to the N over 2 disappear, but these annoying Twitter factors, these eight roots of unity, those still survive, and you get basically a factor I to the power N over 2. And because theta L is not identically zero, that means that I to the power N over 2 has to equal 1, and that is to say that N has to be a multiple of 8, and therefore that all of these epsilons disappear. And in fact, this is not the only proof known of this remarkable fact that a self-dual lattice, self-dual even lattice, has to have rank divisible by 8 if it's positive definite. But I think it's remarkable that one can construct a proof using just complex analysis for that. Of course, it's not my proof. Sarah observed this back when writing course in arithmetic, and it might have been known before that. The result itself, I don't actually know how far back it goes. I've seen it attributed to ARF, but I've not been able to find a reference for that. Anybody know who first proved that the self-dual lattice in Rn exists if an even lattice exists only for multiples of 8? Rodriguez. Well, we'll sell this at some other point, I guess. But at any rate, n has to be multiple of 8. That's quite a powerful result, and one can use that as a starting point for various other mod 8 results. You know, if a lattice is even and has discriminant 2, then n is congruent to 1 or 7 mod 8, things of that nature. We'll probably see some of these examples later in the week. But for now, what does that tell us about the theta function? Well, the theta function is a modular form for the full modular group. Again, weight n over 2. Pardon my handwriting, but I guess you can more or less see what I'm trying to say. And again, those are completely classified. And in some sense, because the group is 3 times larger, the dimension is smaller by a factor of 3 where it exists at all. And that means that theta L is in the algebra generated by these 2 basic Eisenstein series. So E4 is, what is it? E4 is 1 plus 240, sum from m equals 1 to infinity, let's say, sigma 3 of m times q to the m, this being the sum of the cubes of the divisors of m. So that's saying that there is 240 vectors of norm 2, there is 2160 vectors of norm 4, and so forth. And that's just by knowing that it is a self-dual lattice of even lattice of rank 8. Again, there is an unfortunate but inevitable collision of notations. Eisenstein series are denoted by E's, and the special root lattices E6, E7, E8 are noted by E's. And to make matters worse, this index is not the index of the corresponding E lattice. In my notes, I use a sans-serif E for that, so being so thin, it should have about half the weight. I can't, of course, make the same kind of mnemonic when writing with a marker here, but at any rate, this automatically gives us the enumeration of representations by the E8 lattice. And what's more, E4 has weight 4, E6 has weight 6, n over 2 is a multiple of 4, so E6 has to appear to even power, and it is more convenient for computation to say that it's generated by E4 and delta, which is this famous cusp form I get by eliminating the leading term and dividing by 1728 to make it monic. So what is the dimension of this space? Well, remember, we had n over 8 dimensions in the case of a self-dual lattice. In this case, where it's even in self-dual, it is 1 plus n over 24. So if n is at most 16, n equals 8 or n equals 16, the theta function is determined completely. And in dimension 24, let's say, well, some of you know where I'm going with this. I know where I'm going also, but I still need to find the page. Here we go. So that means that if you tell me n over 24 greatest integer part coefficients, C1 up to Cn over 24, in the expansion, theta L equals E4 to the power n over 8, that's an integer, plus the sum from 1 to n over 24, E4 to some power this minus, is that correct? Yeah, minus 3m times delta to the m times Cm. There are this many coefficients, and once you tell me those m coefficients, I know the theta function exactly. So in dimension 8 and 16, there are zero coefficients, so I have no ready theta function. In dimension 24, and also 32 and 40, there is one coefficient to tell, or equivalently, if I know the representation numbers for N2 and 4 up to 2N over 24, these numbers determine the theta series, and therefore they determine all N sub 2M. In particular, in the context of sphere packing, there is a unique way that you can make all of these equal zero in the attempt to make the minimal norm as large as possible. So if you make all of N2, N4, etc., as far as the dimension will allow you to get zero, then the minimal, that determines the tail function uniquely. And in particular, you might hope that you might get lucky at some point, and the next coefficient might be zero as well. That would allow you to have the minimal norm being even larger. But in fact, no. Ziegler already proved that if you make all of these zero, then the next coefficient is positive by an application of something called the Lagrange-Biermann theorem. And by sometime this evening, I'll give him reasonably elementary version of that in my the next exercise in the lecture notes. And the consequence of that is that the minimal norm of an even self-dual lattice is at most equal to twice n over 24 greatest integer parts plus 2. And if equality holds, then we say that the lattice is extremal. That is to say, it has the biggest possible minimal norm among all self-dual unimodular lattices, given even self-dual unimodular lattices, given what we know already. And then its theta series is completely determined. So you can see that that's particularly neat in dimensions which are exact multiples of 24. For n equals 24, you get the Leech lattice. Well, you get the theta function of the Leech lattice, but it turns out to be unique. We'll come back to that a bit later this week. And for n equals 48, you get the theta series whose coefficients I exhibited on this handwritten, well, pre-written table that I put on the board before, 52, 416, 1000, etc. That's where these numbers come from. These are the coefficients of that theta series for q cubed, q to the fourth, etc. Now, this is perhaps a good time for a warning, which is the fact that theta series for lattices taking rational value, whose inner products take rational values, the fact that those are always modular forms for some congruent subgroups, that's true in general, but the proof I'm outlining here doesn't generalize so easily because most congruent subgroups are not just generated by just one's translation and one inversion which corresponds to applying Poisson summation. Poisson is certainly a crucial tool, but we'll have to work harder if we want to get from a general lattice to some fine dimensional space of modular forms. And again, I hope to be able to get to that topic sometime later, but I just warn you that by going to just the case of gamma and gamma plus, I have availed myself of some simplifications that I might not have in general. The other cases for which that is possible, by the way, include the following example. So supposing I have a lattice such as D4, whose dual, the D4 lattice is a so-called checkerboard lattice in four dimensions. It's all the integer vectors whose coordinates sum to an even number. Also the lattice of integer Hurwitz quaternions, it's a D4 root lattice, etc. And its dual, even though it's not quite the same as the D4 lattice itself, it's close enough. It's a D4 lattice with all norms multiplied by half. So if you play the same kind of analysis as before, It's still an even lattice, so the theta function is invariant under changing tau to tau plus 1. But this time, if you apply Poisson, what you wind up with is minus 1 over 2 theta squared, because the discriminant is 4. So I have a factor of 4 to the 1 half, which is 2, times theta d4 star of minus 1 over 2. And if I want to make that, over tau, excuse me, and if I want to make that a functional equation for the theta function of d4, that becomes minus 1 over 2 tau. So this time I have a functional equation for anything generated by tau goes to tau plus 1, and this funny involution tau goes to minus 1 over 2 tau. Now, geometrically, what makes possible the usual description of the full modular group and its fundamental domain in terms of just f and tau is that tau goes to tau plus 1 limits you to real part at most a half, and then if you ask for the biggest possible imaginary part in the orbit, it has to be above this unit circle. And so you get these 60 degree angles here, and that gives you a Stan's fundamental domain for the full modular group. If you have now minus 1 over 2 tau, you have a smaller circle of radius 1 over root 2, but that's okay, that still gives us a triangle group, and now we have a 45 degree angle here. And there's only two more things of that kind you can do. You can go down to 1 over root 3. That would be the same thing that you had if you had a lattice such as the A2 lattice, whose dual was the same thing scaled by a factor of 1/3. You would then have a hyperbolic triangle group with a 30 degree angle here. And finally, you could make it 4, and that would bring you all the way down to an ideal hyperbolic triangle. But that group is equivalent to one we already know, because after scaling all the norms by a factor of 2, we'd be back to our group gamma plus. If you then looked at a lattice which was 5 modular, it is still, the theta function is still going to be a modular form for a certain congruence group extended by one of these double involutions, but the proof will be harder because we'll no longer be able to get it just by applying Poisson and this translation. So that's the kind of warning that I make in general. But for D4 and for any of these two modular lattices, you have a description that's very similar to what we have seen already. That is to say, we find, first of all, that 4 has to be a factor of n. That corresponds to the A as a factor of n before. And again, you get it from the fact that the two generators multiply to something of order 4. And the modular forms of the correct weight are generated by theta d4, which has a nice sum representation. It's an Eisenstein series for that congruent subgroup. So it's a sum over let's say m equals 1 to infinity, not quite sigma 1 of m, but the odd sigma 1 of n, the sum of all the odd factors of m. So for instance, there are 24 vectors of norm 1, 24 of norm 2, 24 of norm 4, 96, 24 times 4 of norm 6, etc. 24 again of norm 8. So it's generated by this, and analogous to that delta, there is something I might call delta 2. Delta, you might know, is the eta function to the power 24. Delta 2 is the eta function of tau to the 8 times the eta function of 2 tau to the 8. And so that's a function, that's a modular form of weight 2, that's a modular form of weight 8. And again, we have this notion of extremal, where in each dimension, this time the dimension is the greatest integer in n over 16. In each dimension, you can try to make the first few coefficients 0. The next one is then positive by the same kind of Ziegler argument, and we have a notion of extremality. So for instance, the first case where you get something past a power of d4, that is when n actually equals 16, you can look at the fourth power of the d4 Taylor series minus 96 times this delta, and you get a power series that starts with 432 q squared plus some higher order terms, and that again turns out to be the Taylor function of a unique lattice, namely the Born-Swall lattice in that dimension. If you go one step further to n equals 32, the first case where you can try to make the minimal norm 6, then you get the Taylor function, it's right here, of, again, there are several lattices known of that kind. The first one that was discovered was Kveberman's. There are several others. They all have this Taylor function in common, and they all have some other properties. For instance, they're all quaternionic. We'll not be able to prove that, but we'll be able to prove a curious consequence of them being quaternionic, having a structure as a module over the Hurwitz integers. And that will be another one of the projects I'm proposing. And so I've now given the background for two of those. How much time do I still have?
Not much.
Not much. Okay. So I will not be able to go over by only negative 1 minute. However, let's see. So to make a long story short, and I will lengthen it when I come back here tomorrow and afterwards, to get at questions such as not only how many vectors there are in a given shell of the lattice, how many vectors are there at given distance from the origin, but also how are they distributed? Like, you know, if you pick that vector of norm 8 in one of these 48 dimensional extrema lattices, use that as one of your coordinates, how are the coordinates of the minimal norm, right? The minimal norm vectors have to be in some slices. How many are there in each slice? So you want both radial and angular distribution, and you get information about that by generalizing these Taylor functions to weighted Taylor functions. This goes back at least as far as Hecke, but it's still not nearly as well known a tool as the ordinary Taylor functions. And very briefly, and I'll say more about this later, again, there are extensive notes on harmonic polynomials. If you have a harmonic polynomial of degree d, then you have the same kind of, then I'm going to define the Taylor function of, I'm just going to use the lowercase version, so I'll define it immediately as the sum of over lattice vectors of the usual factor e to the minus pi norm of v times tau, excuse me, not pi, minus pi, plus pi I times that, but with a factor p of v that depends not just on the norm, but also on where in the shell of radius square root of vv it lies. And as long as your polynomial is harmonic, you have this function equation that looks very much like before, except we have to put in, besides the discriminant factor, we have to put in a power of I, and we have to increase the power of tau over I, and therefore the weight, by d. And that gives you that times the corresponding Taylor function of evaluated at tau. And did I do this right? Well, I certainly did this right if the lattice is self-dual, but in that case, I shouldn't have put in this L here. And so I'm not going to gamble on choosing correctly. So let me just say it's equal to this if L equals L star. And if not, one would put that thing back in and make L star be the appropriate one of these. At any rate, this works for essentially the same reason, which is if you multiply a Gaussian by a harmonic polynomial, the Fourier transform of that is the same harmonic polynomial times the complementary Gaussian times essentially this factor with an extra t to the d. Excuse me? That's right. It can be zero. I believe that this is actually right, but I'll come back to this. Wait a minute. D, you remember, is only allowed to be even. If D is odd, then the whole thing collapses because I'm matching P of V with P of minus V. So it's only a question of whether I have a plus or minus sign here. And I think it is in fact true that this has to vanish at I. For instance, this is going to be of weight N over 2 plus D. And in the case of that weight for the four modular group, well, something of weight 6 for a four modular group does vanish at I. So I believe this is actually, I actually have this correct, even though there is a factor of I to the minus D that appears twice. at any rate, so it's of this weight for whichever modular group it was. In particular, if L was even and self-dual, then it's of this weight for the whole group. And unlike the Taylor functions we started out with, if D is positive, then the only way, remember, you could get a constant term here is to let V be the zero vector, but then this is zero. So that means that it vanishes at a cusp. It's what's called the cusp form. And if you have some bound on the minimal norm, then it has to actually vanish to that order, because the first term you can see then is the one that corresponds to the minimal norm. And that's certainly enough to get you some information about how big these coefficients are, for instance, to get asymptotic equidistribution results. But it's even nicer in the few cases where the space of modular form subject to that condition is actually zero. So in the extreme case, if n equals 24m and L is extremal, you get that theta LP actually has to be zero for lack of any modular forms at all with the right vanishing at infinity if the degree is one of the numbers 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, and 14. And even not using this 14, this gives the fact that the kth shell for each k is a spherical 11 design. That is to say, if you take any polynomial of degree at most 11 and sum it over these vectors, you can evaluate that sum by integrating the polynomial, multiplying by the number of vectors of that size. So the integral over that sphere of the same polynomial, using the measure in which the integral of 1 is 1. This is actually used by people in numerical analysis in the opposite direction. You want to integrate some function, you sum it over the minimal vectors, let's say, of the Leech lattice, and as long as your function can be approximated reasonably well by a polynomial of degree 11 or less, you're fine. I'm almost done. You do that, and the fact that this implies that is something that we are going to explain in greater detail later. Of course, it's in the lectures. This 14 is denoted by Venkova saying that it's actually an 11 and a half design. Just to give an example of how you use that, supposing I didn't know that E8 was the only example in dimension 8. So play the same game as before, take V0, this time of norm 4, and you find that you have these simultaneous linear equations. There are 240 vectors. The sum of the squares of the inner product in the V0 direction is equal to 240. The sum of that arises as 1 over 8 times 8 to the first. The sum over the same coordinates of the fourth powers is equal to that times 1 times 3 over 8 times 10 times 8 squared, which is 576. That's three simultaneous equations and three variables. You can solve them, and for instance, you find that n2 is 14, other than minus 2. And then you do a bit of Euclidean geometry, and you find you have this vector of norm 4, you have a bunch of vectors of norm 2, which have inner product 2 with it. So they project down to vectors of length 1, which are pairwise orthogonal except for the opposite ones. And you have 7 such in a 7-dimensional space. So there's only one possible thing that can happen. These vectors generate an orthogonal frame. Together with that vector, you have D8 in your lattice. And so you've automatically found a copy of D8 in your lattice. It has to therefore be contained in the dual lattice, and that forces your lattice to be E8. And in fact, with a bit more attention, you can use that to count the number of automorphisms of E8. And this is very much like, although much simpler, than what Conway used some years ago to give a 5-page proof of the uniqueness of the Leech lattice. So just to close with a hint of the final project, 3 equations. I told you I have actually 5 or 6 equations. Like, you know, if I put a 128 here for the 6th power, that should still work. How can it be that I have 4 equations and 3 variables and I still have a solution? Well, the 8 lattice exists, so it has to work. But there are other situations where you don't know in advance that there is such a lattice, but yet these extra dependencies mean that you are not able to pull as much out of linear algebra and the spherical design condition as you might hope to, and that's this thing that I facetiously called Murphy's Law. I can explain in some cases, but not others, and I hope to get a bit more insight from some of the students here about that in general. So, more about these topics in the next few days. Meanwhile, I've probably gone over by more than -1 minute, so at least by most people counting of what -1 means, so I think I'll stop here.